So before moving to planar transmission line, first we have to understand why we need a planar transmission line. What are the advantages and disadvantages of non-planar transmission line that we need to understand, right? So in the beginning, introduction part, I have already told you there are several types of transmission line, and some of them we have already studied. So for example, you have coaxial cable, you have waveguide, you have microstrip line, you have strip line. So the non-planar transmission lines are coaxial cable, waveguide, which cannot be integrated with the planar circuit. That is why we call it as non-planar transmission line or 3D transmission line. Even the microstrip line will be kind of 3D, but it can be integrated with the other components in the device. So let's have some brief understanding of the non-planar transmission line and in general the transmission line. What does it will recap your transmission line concept also. So a device used to transfer energy from one point to another point efficiently. So this is called a transmission line. Any device which will transfer energy from one point to another point is called transmission line. Efficiently means if there is no loss, minimum loss, as you are aware of reflection coefficient, VSWR, etc. So now you can understand what is efficiently. If your input impedance is completely matched, VSWR will be 1. So in that way, you can transmit efficiently. So important to be efficient at RF and microwave frequencies, since frequency used are higher than DC and low frequency. So we need to have a transmission line more efficient at higher frequency. We don't bother about lower frequency at all. So at higher frequency, the efficiency should be good. As frequency gets higher, energy loss in the transmission line are more difficult and costly to be retrieved. Because the waveguide and coaxial cable are little costlier compared to microstrip line technology. When we talk in terms of integrated circuit application, also we will not be able to integrate that. So this is the basic transmission line, which is coaxial transmission line. And this is one example of RG59, where you can see this is the plastic outer cover. Then you have outer conductor, which is shown as copper. This is dielectric material. The white color is inner dielectric insulator, which is dielectric material. And D, the last one, is copper core. So it consists of two wire transmission line, and it can be used for higher frequency based on the dielectric constant value. It is highly flexible, so able to be bent without breaking. So it is not having any issue with the flexibility. That is why for wired transmission, mostly this type of transmission line is used for higher frequency. For example, you can see your TV cable. Also in this case, the inner conductor and outer conductor radius will have the same axis. This is the waveguide which we have just finished. The waveguide is having dimension A and B. It's a hollow pipe structure. Two distinct conductor do not present. So there is only one conductor in the waveguide. There is another waveguide which we have discussed, that is parallel plate waveguide. This is rectangular waveguide. Okay, in parallel plate waveguide, yes, there are two conductors present in that. Here, because there is no dielectric material used generally, in general, dielectric material are not used inside this. There are some cases which is called partial loaded waveguide. In that, dielectric material will be used for a different purpose. But in general, you have open waveguide which does not have any dielectric material loaded into this. So this is the reason it is having the speed of wave will be very high, and maximum energy can be transferred using waveguide. Also, it is having high capability of transferring power. The planar transmission lines are, this is also 3D, but can be integrated with normal integrated circuit. Reason we are going to understand. Basically, we are going to discuss two types of transmission line here in planar transmission line. There are more, but we are limiting up to two only, a strip line and microstrip line. So a strip line is, it's a line which is inside a dielectric material. So this is the front view of strip line. So that means the back side also, this will be looking in the same way. So back side also, it will have the same structure. So wherever you cut, it is a cross sectional of that. So you can understand the difference between the microstrip line. If you consider this particular line as a, you can say, in terms of sandwich, okay? So these are the top bread and bottom bread, and in between you have the thin layer of microstrip line, okay? You call it cheese or whatever. But here you have only one side. I mean, the one bread is there. Above that, you have just a line, that is only one cheese. And above that, you don't have any second bread. So that is the difference between the strip line and microstrip line. So we can say strip line is the sandwich structure in which we have two conductors as a ground. So top, the black color conductor, and the bottom conductor is as a ground. In between, we have a line which is inserted into a dielectric material. Dielectric material in the sense, it may be any insulator. It's a plastic, it is durite, it is FR4, any type of dielectric material. So the line is inserted. That means it's already fabricated there based on the width of the line. And this is how electric field and magnetic field lines are there. So as you know that electric field lines are always normal to the conductor. That is why the green color lines are showing as electric field lines, which is always normal to the conductor. The dotted lines are magnetic field, which is circulating the current. So if current is flowing, the magnetic field will be around that. So current will be flowing through the strip line. So magnetic field will be around that. This is the second type of line, which is called microstrip line, which is widely used. And what is the advantage over the strip line? Here on the top, we have a line. And after that, we have free space, or you call it as air. So due to this reason, any type of change in the top is very easy. Suppose you want to do fabrication of this kind of line and this kind of line, this one will be easier. Microstrip line will be easier. Why it is easier? Because this top width and length, whatever you have designed, that can be fabricated using machine or some chemical method of photolithography, where you can remove the unwanted conductors. So generally this come as a sheet of conductor. On top we have a copper, bottom also we have a copper. So this copper we can use as a ground plane. Top copper, I think you must have seen some of the PCBs. PCB sheet will be something like this. On top, based on the design, that can be etched out from that and design can be done. But here the problem is this conductor. So everything depends upon the width of conductor, design of the conductor. Top and ground plane is just a ground plane. So if you want to make any changes or you want to fabricate it, it is very difficult to fabricate, because if you have a material like this, it should be in two parts, then only you can change something. You have a sandwich, you want to change anything into the sandwich in between, you want to put extra cheese, you have to remove the top part, then only you can put the extra cheese, right? So, but here, whatever you want to do, you can do, because you have only one bread, which is in the down. In the top, it is open only. But this facility comes with a disadvantage. What is the disadvantage here? The line is inside a dielectric material, so there is very less leakage. Leakage will be only from this side. The side is open. Open means there is dielectric material, after that it is open, air. But top and bottom, we have ground plane. So it's not open. So the electric field lines, which is passing through this, it will be, I'll show you through the drawing. So if you have electric field lines like this, okay, from here, so there will be some leakage through this. But the leakage is less compared to this. When we come to drawing the electric field of this, you will see leakage is more in case of microstrip line. In case of a strip line, we have leakage is less in the side. And due to this leakage only, there is a concept of effective width. What do you mean by effective width? Means another line in which if we consider everything, like in the side we have air, okay, due to that we have the dielectric material here, epsilon r, and then air. So due to that there will be an effective dielectric constant, and the width will be little bit different from the physical width what is there. So due to that we call it as effective width. Advantage here is, here you have the, so the line, electric field lines are something like this. From the side it will be like this, and then it will come out from the air also, isn't it? It will even start coming out from the air, because it has to maintain the characteristic of electric field, which is normal to any conductor. So in this side it should be normal, here also it should be normal, this side also it should be normal. So electric field will be always, if you have a conductor, so electric field will be always normal to this. These are all normal. After that it may bend to go to ground, and there also it will be normal. So wherever it is touching any of the conductor, it will become normal. And by doing this, what happens is some portion of the electric field will be in air. As I told you, there is nothing above this green color box. We don't have anything. What is there? Air. So property of any electric field will be different in the dielectric material and in the air. So it will depend upon the dielectric constant. If the dielectric constant is same as air, there is no change in the property. But dielectric constant is always greater than 1 for any dielectric material. For air, epsilon r will be 1. So due to this reason, there are more fields which is there in the air. So this advantage of having easy fabrication comes with disadvantage of little loss. But if there is little loss, we can use that as benefit. Or sometimes if we don't want more loss, we'll increase the dielectric constant value. It's something like the dielectric material try to trap the electric field inside the dielectric material. That is the property of dielectric material. So if air dielectric constant is 1 and this dielectric constant is 2, it will have trapping power just twice of the air. But if we increase the dielectric constant, it will even trap more. So this what we have drawn up to this, it will be even lesser one. If we have higher dielectric constant, maybe the line will bend here itself. It won't go up to this one. So due to that, less field, less energy will be lost in the air. So the dielectric material plays a major role in this. And what exactly it does is, it will either allow to radiate more, or it will be confined into the dielectric material. So these two properties are used for different types of design. Now let's say I want to design something using this microstrip line to transfer power from one place to another place using this line. In that case, we should have large value of epsilon r. Large value I am writing in the sense, it should be cost effective also. It should not be like you have just taken large value of epsilon r randomly. It should be cost effective, it should not be very costly. So large value of epsilon r when it is required for transferring power from one place to another place. If you want to make this as a antenna, you want to radiate, because there is radiation property, you want to enhance that radiation. What you have to do is, accordingly, you have to change the size of this line that will be called as patch. And the dielectric material need to be very low. Okay, lower the dielectric material, more will be the loss. And if more will be the loss, means it will be in free space. Loss, where will be the loss? Loss will be in free space. And you want it to be in free space so that it can be received by some other device. So that's why microstrip is also used as an antenna, which is called microstrip antenna. So this is very useful in micro antenna technology also. Okay, here we are concentrating only on microstrip line. This is the few things which I have already discussed. High power handling capability of waveguide is advantage. Low loss, advantage. Bulky, disadvantage. Expensive, disadvantage. So this is advantage, advantage, disadvantage, and disadvantage. So over this disadvantage, there are coaxial lines which is having high bandwidth. Why high bandwidth? Because waveguide is having cutoff frequency. So if there is cutoff frequency, it will only allow after that cutoff frequency. So your operating frequency should be more than cutoff frequency. And also I told you 1.25 times the cutoff frequency. But this coaxial line can work for a large bandwidth because there is no cutoff frequency. It can start from the DC to AC. Even coaxial cable you can use for DC. It is stupid to use at DC because very costly. But you can use it. It will work. Okay. When you talk technically, yes, it will work for even DC, even for the AC, but not waveguide. Waveguide cannot work on DC and even for the lower frequency, lower than the cutoff frequency. So high bandwidth is advantage for the coaxial cable, convenient for test application, advantage, but this is disadvantage. What is disadvantage? Difficult to fabricate complex microwave component in the medium. Now, fabrication with the other microwave components is very difficult in this case. The microstrip line is solution of all these three. So you can see bulky. Bulky is disadvantage. So compact. Another is expensive. So low cost. Difficult to fabricate complex microwave components in the medium. So capability for integration with active device such as diode, transistor, etc. So microstrip line can be integrated with any device. That is the advantage of having microstrip line. And you must be knowing in your mobile phone, even antenna is of microstrip line. And there are several other lines used in your integrated circuit into your mobile phone and your laptop. So first, quickly, I'll go through that strip line and then we'll come to microstrip line. This is the geometry of strip line, geometry. So you can see this line is visible from here. This is the middle point. And then it is parallel to ground and top both. The ground and top both have a distance B. So this is at B by 2. From top also it is at B by 2. Electromagnetic field lines here. E field is this one. S field is circulating the strip line. I think I have discussed all these things. You just simply see this W. W is width of line. Okay, it is consists of top ground plane, bottom ground plane. It is known as sandwich line. Also, it is evolved from the flattened coaxial transmission line. So you have something like transmission line cross section like this. What you do is you flatten it, press from both sides, this side and that side. This will start becoming like this. Then again, if you press, it will be like this. So idea has come from the coaxial only. Only thing is coaxial is round shaped and it should be precise for having center and this conductor. This will be easy to fabricate because this is easy to design because this is square shape. And after that, it is evolved with microstrip line by making it half. The top portion is removed. This top portion is removed. Then this has become microstrip line. B is the distance of ground plane separation. There are two grounds, one ground here, another ground here. Side, we don't have anything. Only ground in up or top and bottom. The region between the ground plane is filled with dielectric, epsilon r. Practically, the center conductor is constructed of thickness b by 2. So normally, the center conductor they can construct for the b by 2. So this is a photograph of a strip line circuit assembly. So whatever lines you are seeing here, these are inside that dielectric material. And this is very, very thin. That is why these things is mentioned here. This thickness is b by 2 in practical case. So if it is b by 2 means, even this side will be having b by 4 and b by 4 distance only left out. Here phase velocity is given by, in general, phase velocity is given by 1 divided by mu naught mu r epsilon naught epsilon r. Since it is dielectric material, we don't have any mu r. Mu r is 1. Mu r will become 1. So this formula for phase velocity is this. And for this, we know this is c. C is given by under root 1 by mu naught epsilon naught. So taking that out, we have c by epsilon r. So propagation constant is given as beta equal to omega by Vp. And phase velocity, if you put, this is the propagation constant. So it is depending upon the k naught wave number. And the k naught is wave number for the free space. Wave number for free space. Because it is directly related with omega mu naught epsilon naught. So for free space, it is k naught into under root epsilon r. Characteristic impedance is L by C, considering lossless. And if you multiply by C above and down, this will become, inside you multiply by C and C. So this is root LC by C, which is 1 by Vp into C. So if you have capacitor known, you can find out the characteristic impedance. L and C are the inductance capacitance per unit length. These parameters we have studied in module 1. The resulting formula for the characteristic impedance is Z naught, which is given by this equation. So if you know the B value and WE value, then only you can calculate characteristic impedance. W is the effective width. Formula for that also will come. So this is the formula for effective width, WE by B. So depending upon the W and B ratio, if W by B ratio is more than 0.35, then you don't have any effective width. Both will be same. Then if you are taking W, width of transmission line, which is B into 0.35, then there is no effective width, because this width is larger. So in this case, there will be more confined electric field. So the small change in width is not taken into consideration. But when the width is very less, if suppose your width is less, then electric field will be more and loss should be taken into consideration. In that case, we have effective width. This is the formula for effective width. So W by B is less than 0.35. In that case, the WE by B is W by B minus this quantity. And you can calculate this quantity and take the subtraction. That will be your effective width. So these formulas assume the zero strip thickness and are quoted as being accurate to about 1% of the exact results. So strip thickness is zero in this case. Okay, this formula does not consider the strip thickness, which just now for practical purpose they are taking b by 2. This is not taken in consideration into this design. Also, you can see the characteristic impedance is inversely proportional to width. Z naught is inversely proportional to width. When width is increasing, so larger width will give a smaller characteristic impedance. Smaller width will give larger characteristic impedance. Okay, so this formula was to calculate if W and B is known, you can find out what is the characteristic impedance. So this is called analysis. It means you have been given with width and the distance between the conductor, and you have asked to analyze what is the characteristic impedance of this line. Another thing is synthesize. Synthesize means you have been given a condition that you have to design a line of Z0 equal to 50 for given dielectric material, let's say having dielectric constant 4.4. Some condition is given. Now you have to find out W by B ratio, and based on that you have to find W and B. So here, by knowing epsilon R and Z0, you can calculate X. By knowing X, you can calculate W by B. So here is the catch. Some information we don't have. We don't have this information. So here we go use hit and trial. Hit and trial means we take first case as, okay, let us consider that it is less than 120. In that we will find W by B ratio. Then we see whether our condition is fulfilled or not. If it does not fulfill, we'll go for the second one. Then apply. Then we'll see the condition is fulfilled or not. Reverse calculation is required for this. And the attenuation due to dielectric loss is given as alpha d equal to k10 delta by 2, where delta is loss tangent, 10 delta is loss tangent. The attenuation due to conductor loss is given as this, and all this value you must be knowing. This is surface resistance, dielectric constant, Z0. A and B value is here. A is this, B is this, and T is the thickness of a strip. So this is for exact calculation when you have thickness is given. Now we are moving to the microstrip line. So these are some questions you can try it by yourself and find out. All the values are given in this. So microstrip line is similar to the strip line. Only thing is the top portion of a strip line, which was present like this, it was like this, is now removed. This was the dielectric material combined with this too. But that is now removed. If you remove that, this portion will come in some other dielectric material, that is air. So now we have air here. So this is air and this is dielectric material. So this portion is falling into the air, and due to that there are more loss, and here comes the effective dielectric constant properties. In the previous case, we did not have an effective dielectric constant thing. We had only effective width. Effective width. That is also for the less than 0.35 ratio. Width W by B ratio is less than 0.35, then only we had this. If the ratio is more, no issues. But here we have effective dielectric constant. That is called effective dielectric constant concept. So what is effective dielectric constant? So we can convert this into a homogeneous material having the same width of line, same distance between the ground and the line, but with a different dielectric material all over, putting effective dielectric constant material. So that is called homogeneous dielectric material. It's surrounded with homogeneous dielectric material of dielectric constant effects epsilon effective, which gives the same property. Okay. You will understand when we go to that particular slide. So here microstrip line is one of the most popular type of linear transmission line. Easy fabrication process, easy integrated with other passive and active microwave devices. Passive, active. Active means diodes, transistor. Passive, any resistance, capacitance or inductance, lumped elements. W is width of the printed thin conductor. So this is width. Width. D is thickness of the substrate. So D is thickness of the substrate. This is D. Epsilon R is the relative permittivity of the substrate. So relative permittivity of the substrate is epsilon r, or it is called as dielectric constant. So microstrip, the structure does not have dielectric above the strip. So microstrip has some of its fill lines in the dielectric region concentrated between the strip conductor and the ground. Some of the fraction in air, already I have explained all these things. In most practical application, the dielectric substrate is electrically very thin. D is very, very less than lambda. This is important. Practical application, thickness of dielectric material is very, very less than lambda. Take an example. Suppose I am using this as at 5 gigahertz. 5 gigahertz means lambda will be, if I just take free space, C by F, 3 into 10 to the power 8 by 5 into 10 to the power 9. So how much we have? And if I multiply with 100, it will come in centimeter. So it's 30 by 5 centimeters. So it's around 60 mm. 6 centimeter, around 60 mm. But usually microstrip line will be between 0.2 to 3 mm. This is the thickness of dielectric material. So what we have assumed here is valid. D should be, thickness should be less than, very, very less than the wavelength. The fields are quasi-transverse electromagnetic, where the fields are essentially same as those of the static case. Quasi-TEM. So since there are two lines here, so it will be TEM. But it is quasi-TEM because both the lines are not having the same width. The ground is having different width, the top is having different width. Due to that, it is transverse electromagnetic mode, but it is not fully TEM mode. It is called quasi-TEM mode. PP is given as phase velocity, C by under root, effective dielectric constant in this case. Beta is same, K naught into under root epsilon E. So based on effective dielectric constant, all these things comes, and effective dielectric constant will be between the range of air and the dielectric material. So if air is 1, dielectric material is having 10, it will be in between 1 and 10. And which side it will be more, that you can find out from the formula. This is the effective dielectric constant formula. Epsilon r plus 1 by 2, epsilon r minus 1 by 2 multiplied by this. So if you know D and W, you can calculate that and find out what is effective dielectric constant. So it's not simply average of these two quantity. No, it is average means we could have just this value, right? This is the average of these two. But we have another portion also. So if you add it together, you will find that the effective dielectric constant always bent towards the dielectric material value. So in a scale, if I write 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. So you have this material and air material, your effective dielectric constant will be somewhere here. So it will be offset towards the dielectric value. Okay, so when you calculate it, you will come to know what is the exact value. Since D and W both are length, here you need to consider both are in same unit to calculate it. All these things, all points you should remember. Should not take different unit here, otherwise it will be you will get the wrong value of effective dielectric constant. So it can be represented using a homogeneous medium. So this is a homogeneous medium which consists of effective dielectric constant entirely, having a structure here, having a microstrip line and ground here. So this will give the same field distribution inside this, or same property as given by the microstrip line. And for the calculation of Z naught, these are the formula which you have to use. By seeing the value, W by D ratio less than 1, W by D greater than 1. If W by D is less than 1, Z naught can be calculated using this. Otherwise, you can calculate using this. All this uses only effective dielectric constant W and D. No other things will be there in the formula. You see, epsilon, D and W is very easy. And this is vice versa. If you have to calculate width, in that case, for given D, if D is given, D is let's say 1.6 mm. Epsilon R is let's say 4.4. Z naught is let's say 50 ohm. You have to calculate this value. Then what you will do? First, you will take W by D. You consider that W by D is less than 2. Use this formula. If you get W by D, by calculating this, if you get W by D less than 2, means you were correct by taking this case. But if you are not getting W by D less than 2, means it is more than 2, you have to go to the second formula. And here you have A, and here you have B. You see B, any other thing? Yeah, epsilon R, which is known. One thing which is unknown is A and B in this equation. For that, you have A and B here. You can find A and B using this formula, calculate it, and put it here. So this is for the W by D less than 2, A, and W by D greater than 2, you have to calculate B. If you consider microstrip line as quasi TEM line, for that you have attenuation constant alpha D, as this is attenuation constant. Is alpha C is attenuation loss due to conductor. So there are two things which will cause loss. Either conductor, in two material is there in microstrip line. We have conductor and dielectric material. So dielectric material will cause loss in power due to its loss tangent. Due to its impurity in the material. If it is pure dielectric, there will not be any loss. If it is having impurity, an impurity is calculated using this 10 delta. In general, 10 delta will be given as 0.01, 0.02 or 0.03, like that. So this value is saying that the dielectric is impure. And conductor loss will be due to its surface resistance, and resistance always causes loss. So this is alpha C. So total loss will be alpha C plus alpha D. Here RS is the surface resistivity of the conductor, which depends upon the conductivity of material, frequency, and the permeability. There are a few examples here. You can note it down and try to do it by yourself. If there is phase shift, how we can find the length, because this is for calculating only width, whatever we have studied here. Length calculation will be based on the lambda. So 90 degree phase shift means 90 degree is your theta phase shift. So beta L will be 90 degree. L will be 90 degree by beta, and beta is 2 pi by lambda. 2 pi is 360 degree lambda. So it's nothing but L is 0.25 lambda. So 90 degree phase shift means 0.25 lambda. You can calculate lambda. Lambda is Vp by F.